Now let's talk about friction. Okay, we basically have two type of frictions. One is the friction between surfaces, okay, and the other is friction between fluids. Okay, the friction between surfaces is known as dry friction, okay, and the other friction is known as fluid friction. Okay, we are going to study dry friction. Okay, the fluid friction part is basically part of fluid mechanics, which we are not covering in this learning program. Okay, so we are basically interested in dry friction. Okay, to analyze dry friction, let us look at a block which is resting on a surface. Okay, let us suppose this is my block which is resting on this surface. We know that when the surface is frictionless, the reaction offered by the surface is normal to the surface. So this is the reaction. However, when the surface is rough, okay, when it is not frictionless, then we have a reaction at an unknown direction. Okay, we are going to try to understand what is this reaction and what is this unknown direction. Okay, I have a rough surface. Let us suppose I give a push of P newtons to this particular block. Obviously, if this push is small, this block is not going to move, right? So this block is not moving. Let me draw up FBD of this block when I have given it a small push and this block is not moving. So my FBD at this instant is going to be something like this. I'm going to have, this is my push, okay, this is my mg, where m is the mass of this block. Okay, now as the block is not moving, okay, it is in equilibrium. Okay, for this particular body to be in equilibrium, there must be a force acting in this direction equal to mg, and there must be a force acting in this direction equal to p. Okay, so these are the components of reaction offered by the surface. Okay, let us call this component as N, which is the normal component of the reaction, and let us call this component as F. Okay, where what is F and N? F and N are components of reaction, okay, due to the other surface, or due to the rough surface. Okay, N is my normal component, F is my horizontal component. Okay, now if I give it a bit more push, let us suppose I increase P from, let's say earlier I had given a push of 10 newtons, now I increase it to say 50 newtons, it is still going to be at rest. Okay, my F component is going to increase, however, because my F component is equal to the P component, which is equal to push. Okay, as I am increasing my push, the horizontal component of this reaction is also increasing. Okay, at a certain point, let us suppose at P is equal to 100 newtons, I reach a stage where this block is just about to move. Okay, so let us try to draw the FBD at that position. So this is my FBD when this block is just about to move. If I make this push just a bit larger, if I add say plus 1 newton to this push, this block starts to move. So we are analyzing the force which is just a bit smaller than the force required to make this block move. Okay, the force would be F dash obviously and is equal to P dash, because this is an equilibrium condition, the block hasn't moved as yet, it is just about to move. Since my P dash is greater than P, which is the initial push, right, my F dash obviously is going to be greater than F. Okay, if I were to make a graph of P dash, or rather P versus F, where what is P? P is the push, okay, and what is F? F is the horizontal component of your reaction. Okay, whoops, horizontal component of reaction. I am going to get a graph something like this. Okay, it varies directly with respect to the push. Okay, and at this instant I am going to have its maximum value, which is equal to the P dash. Okay, what is P dash? P dash is the push which makes the block move. Okay, just if you increase P dash by 1, the block moves. So it is the push which is just about equal to the push that makes the block move. Okay, at P is equal to P dash, my force is given by a particular relation. Okay, that relation is F dash is equal to mu S into N. Okay, my normal component of the reaction we know is always equal to mg. Okay, so I could in a way say that F dash is equal to mu S into mg. Okay, this is what, this is my F dash. Okay, at this point you are going to have your F dash. Let me mark it over here. Now if I still increase this push, and let us say I make it to P dash dash, okay, let's suppose P dash was 100, I make it 150 newtons, the block starts moving. Okay, when that happens, your horizontal component decreases. Okay, it goes something like this, something like this happens. Okay, so when the motion happens, your horizontal component of the reaction decreases and obtains a steady value. Okay, this steady value is given by a relation which is known as, let me give it to you, F double dash. Let us call this particular steady value as F double dash. Okay, F double dash is given by mu k into n. Okay, now let me tell you what is mu s and mu k. Mu s is the coefficient of static friction. Okay, mu k is the coefficient of kinetic friction. Okay, mu s into n gives you the maximum horizontal component of the reaction. Mu k n gives you the horizontal component of the reaction when the body is moving. Okay, let us understand why this force decreases. Okay, look, your friction is between two surfaces. Okay, if I have two surfaces like this, friction is going to exist when these surfaces move with respect to one another. Okay, at a microscopic level, this surface is probably going to have ridges like this, right? And same would be true for the other surface. Okay, so this is the actual picture of the surface. Okay, now because of these ridges, they are going to interlock. Okay, so when the bodies are static, your interlocking is going to be greater as compared to when the bodies are moving. Okay, when the bodies are moving, the interlocking force is going to be lesser, and hence my F dash is lesser. Okay, therefore it becomes constant and is lesser than this value. When the bodies are moving, the interlocking is going to be lesser and it basically assumes a constant value. Okay, so that is your this particular graph. Okay, so let us define our F dash now. My F dash is the frictional force at the time when motion is impending. Okay, frictional force at the instant of impending motion. Impending motion means the motion is just about to happen. Okay, impending motion. Okay, and your F double dash is the frictional force acting when the body is in motion. Okay, so this is frictional force acting when body is in motion. So these are two important relations that you must keep in mind. Okay, understand one thing over here. Your mu, this thing, is not dependent upon the surface area, rather it is just dependent upon the type of surfaces. Okay, the type of surfaces is basically dependent upon the type of materials used. Okay, so if this is ground and you have a steel box, there is going to be a different mu as compared to if this is a concrete floor and this is a wooden box. Okay, so your mu s is dependent only upon the surface, that is the material, and not on the area of the surface. Okay, so let us see how I can use this relation. Okay, let us suppose I tell you that I have a block, okay, which is of say weight 5 kg. Okay, and I give you that mu s for this particular surface, this and this, is equal to, let's say, 0.5. okay, and I give a push of this, say, 10 newtons to this block, then can you tell me whether this push is large enough for the motion to happen? Yes, you can, because we know that the maximum frictional force that is going to be generated is at the instant when the motion is about to happen. And what is that force? That force is equal to 0.5 into n. If you see n over here, this is going to be your n, which is equal to mg, 5 into, let us say, 10. So 5 into g, which is, I am assuming, is 10. So this is 25 newtons. Okay, look, at this instant, if you draw the FBD, it is going to be a 10 newton over here, frictional force over here, your mg, which is coming out to be 50 newtons over here, and your n, which is also equal to 50 newtons. Okay, since your F, which is basically equal to 10 newtons, right, your frictional force is going to be equal to the push as per the equilibrium of this body. Since your 10 is less than 25, your body is not going to move. Okay, until and unless you give a push of at least 25 newtons, your body is not going to move. At 25 newtons, your body is just about to move, and at any force greater than 25 newtons, your body would start moving. Okay. Now let's again analyze our body when the motion is just about to happen. Okay. I have what? I have a mg acting downwards. I have a normal component of the reaction acting upwards. I have the push that is I'm giving, let us suppose P dash acting this way, and I have the frictional force acting this way, which is equal to F dash. Okay, this is at impending motion, okay, at the instant when motion is just about to happen. Okay, instant of impending motion. So at this instant, let us suppose my reaction is like this. Okay, so this is my reaction due to the surface. Okay, due to these two surfaces being in contact. So let us suppose this is my reaction. F dash is the frictional force, which is equal to the horizontal component of my reaction, and N is equal to the vertical component of my reaction. Okay. Let us suppose you have an angle phi over here. Okay. If I call this as R, okay, what is R cos phi? My R cos phi is N. What is R sin phi? My R sin phi is equal to F dash. Okay. Therefore, what is your tan phi? My tan phi is equal to F dash upon N. Okay. At the instant of impending motion, I know that F dash is given by mu s into N. Okay. So I have tan phi is equal to mu s into N upon N, which basically tells me that my tan phi is equal to mu s. Therefore, at the instant of impending motion, you know the angle of your reaction. Okay, and that angle is given by this particular relation, where mu s is your coefficient of static friction between the two given bodies. Okay. Let us call this angle as phi s. Okay, so we know that at impending motion, my phi s is given by this relation. Similarly, when my body is in motion, I know that F double dash is equal to mu k into N. Okay, therefore I have a F double dash over here, I have a N over here, so the reaction and the angle, let us suppose I call this as phi k, I can find out, and that is equal to tan phi k is equal to mu k. Okay, so when the body is moving, you know what is the angle that the reaction makes with vertical. And when the body is just about to move, you know what is the angle with vertical of the reaction. Okay, so at these two times, you know what is the direction of your reaction. Okay, now let's analyze this scenario. Over here I have two blocks. Okay, there is one block and there is another block. Okay, I want to understand what is happening when this block is just about to move. Okay, so we are looking at the impending motion scenario. Okay, when the motion is impending, my FBD of this particular block is going to be like this. Let us suppose the motion is about to happen in this direction. Okay, there is a push in this direction. So FBD is going to be, you have a P over here, okay, you have a frictional force over here, which is going to be mu s n, okay, you have a normal reaction over here, you have a mg over here, okay. I can replace this with r and angle phi s, okay. So what I will do is, I'm going to say this is equivalent to, I'll paste it over here, this is equivalent to this, whoops, I'll take this off here, where this is my reaction and this is my angle phi s, okay. Now, if you look at these two bodies are in contact, okay. So, they are going to have equal and opposite action-reaction pairs. So, if the reaction is acting like this on this body, the reaction is going to be like this on the other body, okay. So, let me draw the FBD of this particular body. The FBD is going to be like this. This is a bigger body, so we'll draw it like this. We are going to have a reaction like this, okay. Let's call this as m1g, m1g, okay, and let me say this is mu s 1 into n, okay. You are going to have a reaction r, or let's say r1, with the given angle phi s 1, okay. Now another force that is acting over here is your weight of the other body, which is going to be m2g, okay, and because this body is kept on the ground, there is going to be a reaction due to that, okay. So this is going to be my reaction. Let us call this as N2, okay. This I am going to call as N1. Now, if you look at this reaction, it has a component in this direction, okay, and it has a component in this direction. Therefore, because you have a component in this direction, it is possible that this body would move in this direction. Okay, how can we tell whether this moves or not? Let us see. Let me just take this thing off. Look, this block again is in contact with this surface. So, there is going to be a friction involved over here also. Let us suppose I call that friction as F2, okay. And let us suppose I also know what is my mu s2, which is the coefficient of friction between block M2 and the ground, okay. So, now my F2 is going to be what? My F2 is going to be R1 sin phi, okay. And if my R1 sin phi s1 is greater than, what is greater than n2 mu s2, then I can say that this block would also move, okay. If it is equal to n2 mu s2, then you can say that this block is about to move, okay. Another important thing to understand in terms of friction analysis is to realize the fact that your friction always resists relative motion, okay. Let us see what this means. So, let us suppose I have two bodies, okay. This is one body and this is another body, okay. I am assuming this body is moving with a velocity of v1, this body is having a velocity of v2, okay. Now, if you have to find out what is the direction of your frictional force, let us analyze this body. If your V1 minus V2 is greater than 0, then your friction force is going to be in this direction. Okay. If your V1 minus V2 is less than 0, then your frictional force is going to act in this direction. Okay. So, an important thing to remember when analyzing friction related problems is that frictional force is opposite to the relative velocity direction. Okay, to the relative velocity direction. What is V1 minus V2? V1 minus V2 is relative velocity of this block with respect to this block. Okay, so if your V1 minus V2 is not greater than 0, you are going to have a friction force in this direction, despite the fact that you have a motion or velocity in this direction. Your motion is also in this direction and your friction is also in this direction. Do not assume that if the body is moving in this direction, friction is always going to be in this direction. That is not the case. It depends on what is happening to the other body which is in contact with this body. Okay. So, your friction force is always in a direction opposite to the relative velocity. Okay.